ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ नमो भगवते वासुदेवाय। ॐ अज्ञानतिमिरान्धस्य ज्ञानाञ्जनशलाकया चक्षुरुन्मीलितं येन तस्मै श्रीगुरवे नमः। श्रीचैतन्यमनोभीष्टं स्थापितं येन भूतले स्वयं रूपः कदा मह्यं ददाति स्वपदान्तिकम्। वन्देऽहं श्रीगुरो श्रीयुतापदकमलं श्रीगुरुं वैष्णवांश्च श्रीरूपं साग्रजातं सगणरघुनाथान्वितं तं सजीवं साद्वैतं सावधूतं परिजनसहितं कृष्णचैतन्यदेवं श्रीराधाकृष्णपादान् सहगणललिता श्रीविशाखान्वितांश्च। हे कृष्णकरुणा सिन्धो दीनबन्धो जगत्पते गोपेश गोपिकान्त राधाकान्त नमोऽस्तु ते। तप्त काञ्चन गौराङ्गी राधे वृन्दावनेश्वरी वृषभानुसुते देवी प्रणमामि हरिप्रिये। वाञ्छाकल्पतरुभ्यश्च कृपासिन्धुभ्य एव च पतितानां पावनेभ्यो वैष्णवेभ्यो नमो नमः। नमो विष्णुपादाय कृष्णप्रेष्ठाय भूतले श्रीमते भक्तिवेदान्त स्वामिनिति नामिने। नमस्ते सारस्वते देवे गौरवाणी प्रचारिणे निर्विशेष शून्यवादी पाश्चात्य देशतारिणे। जय श्री कृष्ण चैतन्य प्रभु नित्यानंद श्री अद्वैत गदाधर श्रीवासादि गौर भक्त वृंद। हरे कृष्ण 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 हरे हरे, हरे राम 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 हरे हरे। सो चैप्टर 2 टेक्स्ट 64 ऑफ भगवद गीता। राग द्वेष विमुक्तैस्तु विषयानिन्द्रियैश्चरन् आत्मवश्यैर्विधेयात्मा प्रसादम् अधिगच्छति। Raga, attachment, dvesha, detachment, vimuktaihi, by one who has been free from such things, tu, but, vishayan, sense objects, indriyaihi, by the senses, charan, acting, atmavashyaihi, one who has control over, vidheyatma, one who follows regulated freedom, prasadam, the mercy of the Lord, adhigacchati, attains. Translation and purport by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. Translation: one who can control his senses by practicing the regulated principles of freedom can obtain the complete mercy of the Lord and thus become free from all attachment and aversion. Please repeat: one who can control his senses by practicing the regulated principles of freedom can obtain the complete mercy of the Lord and thus become free from all attachment and aversion. Purport: it is already explained that one may externally control the senses by some artificial process, But unless the senses are engaged in the transcendental service of the Lord, there is every chance of a fall. Although the person in full Krishna consciousness may apparently be on the sensual plane, because of his being Krishna conscious, he has no attachment to sensual activities. The Krishna conscious person is concerned only with the satisfaction of Krishna and nothing else. Therefore, he is transcendental to all attachment. If Krishna wants, the devotee can do anything which is ordinarily undesirable, and if Krishna does not want, he shall not do that which he would have ordinarily done for his own satisfaction. Therefore, to act or not to act is within his control because he acts only under the direction of Krishna. This consciousness is the causeless mercy of the Lord, which the devotee can achieve in spite of his being attached to the sensual platform. So we'll just go to the next verse as well. So we can get some context. Chapter 2, text 65. Prasade sarva dukkhanam hanirasyo pajayate prasanna chetaso hyasu बुद्धिः पर्यवतिष्ठते. Translation: For one who is so situated in the divine consciousness, the threefold miseries of material existence exist no longer. In such a happy state, one's intelligence soon becomes steady. So going back to the previous verse, this is something which is very important. Ultimately, our whole life is to get the mercy of the Lord. Now, we always say, take prasadam. That prasadam is the mercy of the Lord. Because we offer him the food and he takes the food and leaves everything back for us. He's eating and our eating is not the same. Sometimes atheists, they say, you are offering food to God, but where is he eating? And there have been instances where Krishna or Ganesh, you know, they have taken milk. You know, the murti, they have taken milk. So for people, I think about few years ago, many years ago, there was one incident where Ganesh all over India was taking milk like that. And about few years ago, Krishna was taking milk like that. So for me, it doesn't surprise me at all. For many people, it's, oh, Krishna is taking Krishna. Krishna is every day taking. But the thing is, we don't have the faith. So that's why Krishna engineers this kind of situation sometimes to instill the faith in us that he is actually taking. But if we understand the way Krishna actually takes, then we will better appreciate what is prasadam. And that is explained in the Ishopanishad. See, when we eat, the food is finished on the plate. But Krishna is so perfect that even after he eats, it still is remaining there. So this explains Ishopanishad invocation mantra. Om Purnamadah Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnameva Vasishyate. The personality of Godhead is perfect and complete. And because he is completely perfect, all emanations from him, such as this phenomenal world, are perfectly equipped as complete wholes. Whatever is produced of the complete whole is also complete in itself. Because he is the complete whole, even though so many complete units emanate from him, he remains the complete balance. See, for example, our body is a complete whole in itself. The universe is a complete whole in itself. It's a self-sustaining mechanism at every level, whether it's a micro level, macro level, cosmic level, every level. So that's how Krishna engineers, whatever comes out of him, it's complete in itself. So even, that's why Srila Prabhupada said, Krishna is so complete that even from Krishna, if you take Krishna away, if you take Krishna from Krishna, he still will remain Krishna. That's why in the Ras Lila, he was dancing with so many millions of gopis actually. But each gopi was thinking that he is dancing with her only. That many times he expanded himself. And even in Dwaraka, he had 16,108 wives. And each wife had a palace, separate palace. Not just ordinary palace, very, very grand. And with each wife he had 10 children, 10 sons and 1 daughter, 11 children. Now just imagine the size of his family, his children, grandchildren and all that. And he was doing different things at the same time. Narad Muni, he observed this thing in Krishna. So he went to Dwaraka to see, he was talking with Rukmini in one palace. In another palace it was night, he was sleeping. In another palace he saw, all the same time, just passing by. Different palace he was doing different things in the same Dwaraka. In some he was playing with his children, some he was meditating, some he was practicing archery. He was astonished because a yogi can also do this to an extent. A perfected yogi, he can expand himself into 8 forms at the same time. But all the 8 forms will do the same thing at any given time. They cannot do different things at the same time. But Krishna, 16,108, all were doing different things. So Narad Muni was totally, he was stunned by the display of Krishna's opulence. So that's Krishna. So even if you take Krishna away from Krishna, still will remain Krishna. So Krishna minus Krishna is still Krishna, it's not zero. So that is the meaning of complete. Similarly, he will take all the prasadam, still the prasadam he will leave it for us to take. That is explained in the Bhagavad Gita. Why he leaves? What is prasadam? Yajna shishtasinah santo muchyante sarvakil vishay bhunjate te tvagham papa ye pachanti atma karanat. Third chapter, 13th verse of Bhagavad Gita. You see, the devotees of the Lord are released from all kinds of sins because they eat food which is offered first for sacrifice. Others who prepare food for personal sense enjoyment verily eat only sin. So sometimes, many, all Indians actually, Hindus, they think prasadam means something which is a little bit on the palm, and that's it, that is prasadam. The meals they will have somewhere in the restaurant somewhere. No, our meals, whatever we eat, should be prasadam. Only prasadam. Otherwise, even vegetarian food is sinful. There is sin involved. Of course, not as sinful as meat, but still sinful. You see, others who prepare food for personal sense enjoyment verily eat only sin. We must offer to Krishna and then only eat. Then it is prasadam. Then they are released from all kinds of sins. This is the mercy. Prasadam means mercy. This is the mercy of the Lord. He releases us from sins just by eating. Sometimes people say, no, I don't want to come only for prasadam. I want to, do some seva. No, even if you have time only for prasadam, please come. Because just by eating alone, you will gain perfection. There, who is the perfect example of that? Narad Muni himself. Narad Muni, Narad Muni? In his previous life, who he was? He was a maid servant son in the forest. Shudra. Not very intelligent, not very educated. Nothing he knows. He doesn't even know who his father is. That kind of family. Because before that he was a Gandharva in the heavenly planets. He was a singer. And he was singing, instead of glorification of the Lord, he was singing about nature and all this. The heavenly denizens, they cursed him. What is this? Why are you not glorifying Krishna? Why are you using your talent for just some meaningless thing? What nature? What? Go. You are fit to become Shudra. See how strict they are in the heavenly planets. Here, anything they are singing. Love songs, vulgar songs, anything goes here. But there, even if one is very talented, if he is not glorifying the Lord with his talent, will be cursed. So in that way, Narad Muni, he was a Gandharva, he was cursed to become a Shudra. So he became a Sudra family, Sudra mother, her son, maid servant son. So Sudra means it's not about discrimination. Sudras are generally not very advanced in their culture and habits and cleanliness and all these things. That's the meaning of Sudra. So he was like that, but fortunately for him, devotees who are pure devotees, they were traveling, sannyasis, and for 4 months of the rainy season, Chaturmasya, which is going to start. So the 4 months of the rainy season, they won't move anywhere. They will put a hut or something, cottage, and they will stay for 4 months because it rains. And after the 4 months, again they will start. And in the 4 months, they will do very severe tapasya, very severe austerity. So many rules are there. So they actually put up a cottage nearby where his mother was living and he was living. So seeing the sadhus, the mother was very inclined to serve them. So she cleaned their place, or got some things for them, helping whatever way. But of course they will not eat her cooking, they will cook for themselves. So anyway, after the devotees, they ate, the sannyasis, he asked them permission, can I eat some of your remnants of what you have eaten? So he ate that. The remnants of not only Krishna, they have offered to Krishna and eaten, but whatever remnants were on their plate, that he ate. Usually nobody eats anybody as remnants. Uchishta, it is called. Uchishta means, you know, it's not fit to be eaten. But it is an exception in the case of a exalted saintly person. We must take that uchishta. Three things from the saintly person: the dust of his feet, the water that has washed his feet, and the remnants of foodstuff he has eaten. These three things are very potent. Therefore, in those days, the culture was the sannyasis, they will invite to the home and wash his feet, and that water they will put on all the head, and they will also drink. Even Krishna did that when Sudama came to his palace. He was king. Krishna is supreme personality of Godhead. When his Brahmana friend came, he immediately came and bowed down to him, washed his feet, made him sit on his own bed, and Rukmini, the Lakshmi herself, she is fanning him. And he washed the feet and he put on his head and Rukmini's head also. This is how sadhu must be treated. Of course, he must be a real sadhu. He cannot be a quack and expect to be worshipped. No. Kali Yuga, that is going on. So anyway, so this is the way. So here we will see this verse.
उच्छिष्टलेपान अनुमोदितो द्विजये सकृत्स्मभुञ्जे तदपास्तकिल्बिषः एवं प्रवृत्तस्य विशुद्धचेतसः तद्धर्म एवात्मरुचिः प्रजायते.
श्रीमद् भागवतम कांटो 1 चैप्टर 5 वर्स 25. सो नारद मुनि इज एक्सप्लेनिंग हाउ हिज हार्ट बिकेम प्यूरिफाइड. वंस ओनली, by their permission, I took the remnants of their food. Only once he took. And by so doing, all my sins were at once eradicated. Thus, being engaged, I became purified in heart, and at that time, the very nature of the transcendentalist became attractive to me. Why people are not attracted to Krishna? Why people are not attracted to Bhagavad Gita and all this? Why? Because they are not free from sins. The sins were at once eradicated. This is the point. You know, let's see Bhagavad Gita. Even though people suffer, they still will not. What is happening?
One second. Wait.
is not showing still. I don't know what happened. One second. Let me see. Is there a kind of loose connection or something? Check, check. So anyway, Bhagavad Gita chapter 7 verse 28, it is stated, it's all connected well. What does it show? Nothing, just black. That's strange. Can you just like unplug and replug?
No.
Wait. Hold on. Can you unplug and replug?
No.
Is it coming? Unplug. Some technical issues with the display. So anyway, I will just continue. Just a moment. It's very strange. No. Come? Okay. So you can see Bhagavad Gita chapter 7 verse 28. Yesham to antagatam papam jananam punya karmanam te dvandva moha nirmukta bhajante mam dridhavratah. Persons who have acted piously in previous lives and in this life and whose sinful actions are completely eradicated are freed from the dualities of delusion and they engage themselves in my service with determination. So why people don't come here? Not because of this reason and that reason. No, mainly they are not freed from their sinful activities. They will say a million excuses. Srila Prabhupada said, there are a million reasons to leave Krishna. But there is only one reason to stay. You are interested in serving Him. You are interested in loving Him. That's it. You will endure anything in order to love Krishna. That is love. Love means when the test comes, it is not that I give up the love. No, that is not love even. If we want everything to go our way, that is not love. Love means, despite nothing going our way, we should not give up Krishna. That is love. Krishna will test. Pandavas, perfect example. They were the most staunch devotees. Krishna even became their messenger. Krishna became their driver. That much they are qualified. But their whole life was full of challenges. Not a single moment of so-called peace. But not once did they complain to Krishna. Recently there was somebody shared WhatsApp, something going on. The Hindus, I don't know how cursed they are nowadays. They absolutely don't read the books and they come up with their own explanations. Lord Ram also insulted. With this kind of story, you know. Then Krishna also now. So Ram's story was that a mother had a daughter and she was pregnant. So she asked the daughter, you want a brother or sister? She says brother. You want a brother like who? Then she said, I want a brother like Ravana. Then the mother becomes, what is this? How can you ask like that? Why don't you ask for a brother like Ram? Prabhu, don't book, put the book on the floor. Krishna's song book. Yes, Sri Siradha Madhama. So, why don't you ask for a brother like Ram? What is this? Who has taught you these things? Then she will ask the mother, why, how long will you keep wanting a son like Ram? Huh? When he kidnapped Sita, he did not touch her. Although he could have violated her, he did not. He waited for her approval. And because his sister was insulted, her nose was cut by Lakshman. He even waged war against Ram. But who is Ram? Huh? He first of all did not care, take care of his wife. She was kidnapped. And then when she was so chaste, so faithful, after the war was finished, he asked her to walk through the fire. And after she did all that, come back, and again he banished her when she was pregnant. How long will you ask for a son like Ram? How to answer this question? Therefore, we wrote an article for our magazine in one of our issues, completely smashing this nonsense. They are experts at twisting facts. Experts. Firstly, Ravan was not waging the war against Ram because of his sister's nose being cut. He little bit, you know, he was agitated, but he was not to the point of waging a war. When she knew also, the sister knew how lusty his brother was. Therefore, she described the beauty of Sita. Then he got interested. And when he actually kidnapped her, he did not violate her because he was cursed. He was cursed by Rambha, Rambha's husband, Nalakuvara, Kuvera's son. When he actually went to heavenly planets and raped Rambha, then her husband, Nalakuvara, he cursed him that the next time he tries to violate a woman, he will immediately die lifeless. He will fall lifeless on the ground. That's why he did not. And later on, Vedavati also cursed. The Vedavati only became Sita. So, he was fearful of that curse, which is why he did not touch her. Otherwise, there was no... He already violated so many women in his life. So many, thousands. So, and Ram. Why he... first of all, Ravan had to be killed. Ram, why the Lord comes to this world? To protect the devotees and to kill the demons. Ravan had to be killed somehow or other. Did Ram not know that this so-called magical deer was actually a Rakshas? He knew. And Lakshman also knew. He is also Supreme Personality of Godhead. He is also Bhagavan. He also knew. Although they played the part of humans as if they did not know. You know, they knew very well what was going on. But it had to be done because otherwise there was no reason for Ram to fight Ravan. See? And the devotees, they won't complain. Sita never complained. Sita never complained. They know. And when she was kidnapped, and of course Ram was searching for her, and you know, of course Ram knew. As a god, he knows everything. But he was playing the part of an ideal human being. So anyway, when the war was then, why she had to go through the fire test? First thing is to prove her chastity. How strong Sita was, that not even for a moment did she think of anybody else than Ram. She did not think of anybody else but Ram all the time. That is her chastity. So to prove that. Second thing, actually in Agni Puran it is mentioned that Sita, when she was in the ashram, when Ravan came to kidnap her, when she went inside to bring the fruits for him, and when she was actually kidnapped, So when she went inside, she went into Agni's custody, and Maya Sita was who came out. It was a illusion Sita who came out, and that's because Sita cannot be touched by anyone but Ram. Actually, there was this Chaitanya Mahaprabhu met this devotee who was always crying. He was a big bhakta of Ram. So he was always seen crying. Why? Because he cannot take it that how can the supreme goddess, you know, the wife of Narayan, Sita, who is Lakshmi herself, was touched by a demon like Ravana. How could that have happened? He was always crying and crying and crying every day. Then Chaitanya Mahaprabhu showed this evidence from Agni Puran to pacify him. You see, it is not actually Sita who was carried away. He is Maya Sita. And when the whole thing was finished, war was finished, when he asked her to walk through the fire, she went into the fire. The Maya Sita went into the fire and the real Sita came out from the fire. Because Agni, she was in his custody until the whole war was over. This is the rahasyam. This is not ordinarily known to people. But in the Agni Puran, this is mentioned. So these intricacies of Krishna's Leela is very hard to fathom. Or Ram's Leela, all Krishna's, all avatar. So immediately jumping to conclusion, we should not do that. The Lord is all auspicious. All his activities are always auspicious. He is always ready to give his mercy. He will never be cruel. And the so-called separation between Sita and Ram, almost always they were separated. And then Sita even gave up her life. So on the surface it looks very sad and tragic. He is doing many things in that Leela actually. By showing this, he is showing that this attraction between male and female is not going to be a platform of permanent happiness. Everybody wants a home, sweet home, you know, happy family. It's not going to happen. That's not the way this material world is designed. It is to show that even if the man is as qualified as Lord Ram, and if the woman is as qualified as Mother Sita, still there will be troubles. He wanted to show this. That is the external drama. Internally, there is a science of bhakti which is so confidential. It is the highest ecstasy of devotional service, bhakti. That means, it's called vipralambha. This is rarely understood by anyone. Vipralambha means the ecstasy of separation. As they say, there is a saying in English, separation makes the heart grow fonder. You know, when you are with somebody, you take it for granted. When the person like goes out for an office, you know, tour or whatever, he misses for, you know, like 2-3 weeks, then you actually really miss that person. When he's away, not when he's around, you will, you know, like even maybe fight with him or what. But when he's away, oh, then you'll start to miss the person. So this is just a dim reflection of what this Vipralambha Seva is. The happiness because of the omnipotence of the Lord. Now, if I remember someone who is not here, I am only remembering in my head. I am actually not associating with that person. It's not possible. I am just thinking of that person. But in Krishna's case, whether you chant his name or whether you remember him or whether you see him, it's the same. When we chant Hare Krishna, Krishna is already there on our tongue. The Krishna, the person is already there in the tongue. Abhinatvan namanami, no. There is no difference between his name and him. Not like our name, like we have a name, but it is just an attachment, I mean a thing that is attached to our body. Our name is so and so, my name is Tattvavit. So that name is given to this body. But the name, it's not me. Like water, if I chant water, 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 it does not have the same effect of drinking the water. So the substance water and the name water is two different things. But in the spiritual world, the name and the substance is the same. This is the non-dual nature of the spiritual world. There is no duality, there is no dvaitam. This is the real advaitam. Where everything, the name of Krishna, there is no difference between name and Krishna himself. So, and the thought of Krishna and Krishna himself, there is no difference. So, when one is thinking of Krishna, he is with Krishna. So, Sita Devi, she was thinking of Ram always. So, she was actually with Ram. She never separated from Ram. And Ram also never separated from Sita. Externally, it appears so. But internally, it is even greater than meeting. Sambhoga and Vipralambha. That's why Radharani's love for Krishna is even greater than Rukmini's love for Krishna. Or even Lakshmi's love for Narayan. Lakshmi wanted to enter Rasleela. She could not. Because the level of surrender, the level of surrender that is required to enter Rasleela, even Lakshmi could not qualify. Because Rukmini, Lakshmi, they have, or even Mother Sita, they have this confidence that the Lord is my husband. Whatever it is, he is my husband. So he will never go away from me. So there is a reason for them to love him. But in Radharani's case, there is no such contract. It's purely Krishna's will. So therefore Radharani, if she feels when Krishna is not there, she will feel, when can I meet him? And when he is there, she will think when he will leave. He may leave anytime because there's no binding contract for him to be with her. So there's no concrete reason for her to love him. But still she loves. Without any condition. Whereas Rukmini has a condition. No, he is my husband, therefore I have love. That's why I always say the story. Narad Muni, Narad Muni is, he got a headache. This story I have told many times. So Narad Muni was going to Dwaraka. Then Krishna had a headache. So Krishna asked, Narad Muni asked, why you are having headache? What is this? You are God? And he said, the ointment is my devotee's foot dust, the dust from my devotee's feet, if you apply here, the headache will go away. So he thought very easy. Then he asked the queens, starting with Rukmini, everybody chastised him, we are wives, how can we put our dust on his head? We have to take his dust on our head. What, you are teaching us to go to hell, or what kind of sadhu are you? So all the queens refused. Then he went to the city center, Dwaraka, because all are devotees in Dwaraka. So he went there and asked them, please, Krishna is having a big headache, so you are all devotees. He is asking some dust that will cure him. Dust from your feet, please give some. Nobody goes, he is our master. How, we are his servants, we are his eternal servants. How can we give our dust? No. You are sending us to hell. What is this? So they also got angry with him. Then he came back to Krishna. Krishna, this is more difficult than I thought. Nobody is giving. What is this trick? What are you playing with me? And he said, you go to Vrindavan and ask the gopis, they will give you. And he was thinking, how will they give? They will also say the same thing. Then he went there anyway. He asked them in a roundabout way, because he was already chastised by he was already scolded by the queens and the Dwaraka. So he was very carefully trying to tell what Krishna is. So Krishna has this headache, he needs the ointment. Ointment is the dust of his devotee's feet. So he said, you are his greatest devotee, so can I take some dust? They said, stop your talking. Take some dust and go, Take as much dust as you want and go. Why you are waiting? Krishna is having headache and you are giving big lecture here. What is this? Take as much dust as you want. And Narada Muni said, how are you saying this? How come you are not afraid of going to hell? And he said, let us go to hell, so what? Krishna's headache must be cured first. We don't mind going to hell. Take this dust and go. Then he understood that they have absolutely no reservation in their love for Krishna. They don't care whether they go to hell, they go to... Well, it doesn't matter. If they have to suffer in hell for a million years because of this giving of their dust to Krishna's head, then they are prepared to do that. But his headache must go away. They only want Krishna to be happy. This is real love. So this qualification that the gopis have, even Rukmini or Lakshmi does not have. That's why Radha Krishna love is the topmost. And it's also very confidential. Not many people understand. People can easily relate to Ram, Lord Ram, because he is Ekapatnivrata, you know, only one wife. Yes, yes, yes. Krishna is a bit, you know, playboy kind of. They will think like, even Hindus. He is not so morally, no, it's completely misunderstanding Krishna. Krishna can do anything. Even if he, what, why only 16,001? All the women of the world is supposed to be enjoyed by him only. He is the only enjoyer of everybody. By his marrying so many, he is not wrong. And he can maintain them, he can, you know, do justice to all of them, and he can be with them at the same time. Not that he is enjoying with one queen and all the 16,107 of them are jealous, you know, waiting for him. No. Everybody was, Prabhu, there. So everybody was happy in Krishna's association. You see, that's how Krishna is. We cannot, that's why his Rasila, all these things are not understood by the general public. They think, you know, it is some boys and girls dancing. No, no, no. It's not like a clubbing or pubbing. Completely different, completely. So anyway, the point is that Krishna will always extend his mercy, prasadam. But we, how much we surrender, that much he will reward us with that prasadam. Actually, he will give everything, but we can only take as much as we surrender. Just like the sun. There is a saying, the moonshine is not denied to the Shudras. Moonshine or sunshine, it does not discriminate whether one is a Shudra or one is a Brahmana. You know, only Brahmanas have sunlight, a Shudra is a dark shadow. No, it doesn't happen that way. This is sunlight everywhere or moonlight everywhere. The opportunity is there for everyone. Krishna's mercy is there for, how much we want to take. If I want to be locked up in a dark room, I can't blame the sun for not, sun is there, I am not taking advantage of it, so I am to be blamed. So therefore Krishna says in the 4th chapter of Bhagavad Gita, ye yatha mam prapadyante tam sthathaiva bhajami ham mama martmanu vartante manushya partha sarvashaha. As all surrender unto me, I reward them accordingly. Everyone follows my path in all respects, O son of Pritha. Just like a criminal, he doesn't want to follow the law of the government. But he is not left with a choice. He has to follow the law of the government. In fact, a more stringent law in the jail. If he did not try to defy the law of the government, he would be under civil law. But because he tried to defy the law, then he will be under a more stringent law, which is criminal law. So the more we try to escape, the more we will be trapped like quicksand. This karma is like that. The law of karma is like that. The more we try to defy it, the more we will be sucked in. Therefore, surrender to Krishna is the best option. In fact, if we at all want happiness, that's the only way. But as much as we surrender, that much his reward we can experience. But his reward is, it's not that he's partial. He's impartial. Just like law is the same for everyone. Why somebody is excelling at something and somebody is put in the jail? It's not that the government hates that person or something. He did something stupid. Something which is criminal or something. And he is punished. Somebody is doing well, you know, making good use of his time. Everybody has the same 24 hours in a day, same 7 days a week. Same 30 days a month, I mean same 12 months a year. So how we make use of that time, how we make use of this human life, depending on us, the opportunity is the same for everyone. It's only what we make out of it. The best thing we can make out of this life, human life, is this. लब्ध्वा सुदुर्लभमिदं बहुसंभवान्ते मानुष्यमर्थदमनित्यमपीह धीरः तूर्णं यतेतनपतेदनु मृत्युयावन्निश्रेयसाय विषयः खलु सर्वतः स्यात्। After many, many births and deaths, one achieves the rare human form of life, which, although temporary, affords one the opportunity to attain the highest perfection. Thus, a sober human being should quickly endeavor for the ultimate perfection of life, as long as his body, which is always subject to death, has not fallen down and died. After all, sense gratification is available even in the most abominable species of life, whereas Krishna consciousness is possible only for a human being. So our human life, the speciality is not that it's the same in every other way except God consciousness. It's the same as animal life. It is also temporary. It is also full of miseries. It has birth, death, old age and disease. Same as the animals. Eating, sleeping, mating, defending. The domain of activities and the domain of suffering and enjoyment is the same. The only thing we have extra than the animals is that we have the faculty to understand God and love Him. If we do not use our human life to understand who is God and if we don't love Him, then we are living a polished animal life and next time we will actually become an animal. Krishna is seeing as Paramatma, oh, I have given this person a human body and he behaved like an animal. Why he doesn't need a human? Get lost. Go to the wild. Become an animal. That's it. Krishna himself says in the 16th chapter, for those who are envious of me, those mischievous, that do not want to follow my instructions, I perpetually cast them into demonic species of life. Let them be as a fish, or as a zebra in the forest, or lion, or a snake. It's fun there. On camera, what we are seeing on National Geographic, it's already so, and what all things are happening without being shot. How much suffering in the wild, it's constant danger. We are at least able to sit like this. In the wild, no. Every moment you have to be very alert, fighting for your life. The fish is the worst of all. The fish eats one fish and then gets gobbled by another fish. And then gobbled by another fish. The fish life is the worst of all. So many sizes of fish and each eating another like this. So don't waste this golden opportunity. Consider you and the amount of species that are there, amount of living entities. Trillions and zillions, gazillions of species. Living entities. Out of that only how many? Only 7 billion humans only. It's so less. 0.00000001%, maybe not even that. Of the total number of species. Not only of Earth. We're talking about the entire universe. Everywhere there is life. So how rare it is. And still we waste our time. Still we waste our time in cinema. And still we waste our time. Not only now wasting, our future also we are wasting. Because now if I do sinful activity, even if I do pious activity, whatever it is, I have to take another birth. I am preparing myself for another birth. And we mindlessly commit sinful activities. Eating meat, intoxicating, gambling, womanizing. Mindlessly, without any forethought. Oh, I like this, especially food. It's so rampant now. Anything people are eating. Without any consideration. How much I am going to suffer for this one dinner. Today's dinner. Oh, I am going to the restaurant. Okay, $6 per dinner something. No. That's not the payment for the dinner. The payment, next life I got to become that animal. And I'll be chopped. How many times I'm going to eat? That many times I'm going to chop. And we're totally, completely oblivious to this fact. And think, no, I still like, I still have a craving. I will slowly stop. Some people, I will slowly stop. How? If a poison, will you slowly stop taking it? Or just completely stop it? It's poison. So we should think like that. We should understand how painful actually it is for the animal and how much more painful it is going to be for me. So we have to stop these things. Sinful life, stop, and then chant Hare Krishna. If we chant Hare Krishna and read this, we'll get the strength to stop sinful life and be steady on that path. And one day you will come to a place where you will absolutely have disgust for that kind of life. Then you have advanced. When we have that virakti, complete disgust for materialistic way of life, all the sinful activities, that's when it is a sign of advancement. You ask the devotees, the same devotees who used to eat meat before coming to Krishna consciousness and who used to like meat, now they can't even take the smell of that meat. That is the purification that happens when you surrender to Krishna. You will see the horrible nature of that activity, that sinful activity. But when we are not, what horrible? It's just food. That's how we see it. That's why the same thing the devotee is seeing and karmi is seeing, but the devotee's vision is totally different from the karmi. The same thing. One is having disgust, one is having, he is slurping away. Why? Because of guna, tamogun, rajogun, sattvagun. Once you become sattvic, or even shuddha sattva, a devotee, that's it. He has no taste for these things. In fact, he feels compassion. That's why when even going to the post office, from here to this post office, I have to pass by this meat restaurant, hawker center, and all the ducks are hanging as horrible. Just the sight of it makes me. So that's how you should feel. If I was hanged there, how can somebody with a sane mind do that? You should always think. That's why Atmavat Sarvabhuteshu. A real pandit, a real learned man means not that he has a big PhD, that's a useless certificate. It's fit for the garbage bin. The real education means he must, three things, Matravat Paradareshu. He must see every woman as mother, not girlfriend. And Paradraveshu Loshtravat. He must see other people's opulence as garbage. That means, not become envious of, he has that. How we see garbage? We don't become envious of garbage. So we're not interested. So that, like that, we should not be interested in other people's wealth. And Atmavat Sarvabhuteshu, we should treat others as we would like to be treated. As they say, give respect, take respect. Then you kill the animal, you don't want to get killed. What is that? If somebody puts a knife at your throat, how will you feel? The same thing the animal is feeling. But we don't think, that is food. But when a dog is killed, that is cruel. Cat, that is cruel. But pig, that is okay. Cow, then okay, fine. Chicken, okay, fine. Why? What is the difference between the cat and the cow or the dog or the chicken or what? Why dog killing or cat killing is a big crime? It's a heinous, most, all kinds of words. And when it is a cow, that is food. Goat, that is food. No brain, no intelligence at all. Completely disillusioned. Completely an illusion. How is a cat different from a pig? Or just because you like it? This is what the problem is. Because they like it, they like a dog. Oh, a dog is cute. So dogs should not be killed. Because you like them. You don't care about dogs. You just only care what you like. Or because you think of a pig is food, kill it. A bird is food, kill it. So, we have to become a little more intelligent. We have to see through these things and act accordingly. This is a very dangerous path. Very, very dangerous. We are walking on a razor's edge. We will be cut in half. That's why when some natural disasters happen, tsunami, it has to happen. These things will increase. I'm telling you. These things will increase. Because the amount of sin is not going down. Don't expect that the world will become a better place. It will not. Because the amount of sin is only increasing. If it can become a better place, it is only by one effort. Krishna consciousness movement. Only this movement can save this world. Not the environment specialist or global warming or this and all, not going to save the world at all. Or the United Nations or the UNICEF. Forget it. Nothing of those things are going to save this world. Only this Krishna consciousness movement. The reason the world is suffering because of lack of Krishna consciousness. Otherwise the Lord has enough ample supply to supply for to everybody. Why people are not getting them? Why people are suffering? Inadequate. Why? Why is inadequacy? Because of their own sinful reactions. And that sinful reaction can be eradicated by the Lord's prasadam. Not only the food prasadam, but His mercy. We need His mercy in every way. So to invoke His mercy, we must call out for the Lord. That is this chanting of Hare Krishna. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare. Hare Ram, Hare Ram, Ram Ram, Hare Hare. We have to call out. Then we will be easily saved. Alright. We will stop here. And then our mind will become steady. All these anxieties, ups and downs, positive, negative, everything you will easily climb across. There were people come and ask us, Prabhu, I want to control my mind, what should I do? I want to control my anger or lust or these desires. Only one solution. Chant Hare Krishna. That's why there's sometimes you're telling the same solution for every problem. That is the point. There is only one solution for everything. If I don't understand that there is a solution, then you can read our books. Slowly you will understand why this is actually the solution. Control of the mind can easily be achieved. But if we profess some kind of yoga, this, that discipline, and we are not interested in Krishna, then Shramayeva hi kevalam, last two verses I will show. Dharma svanashita pumsam vishvaksena kathasoya notpadeyat yadiratim Shramayeva hi kevalam. The occupational activities a man performs according to his own position are only so much useless labor if they do not provoke attraction for the message of the personality of God. So if you become very honest or very truthful or very caring or whatever, but if you are not Krishna conscious, all that is useless. We are not even honest. We are actually a thief. We are taking everything from Krishna and not even saying thank you. Atheists. If I take something from you, I should say thank you. That is general etiquette. Basic etiquette. But if I am taking everything from Krishna, the air we are breathing, water we are drinking, food we are eating, sunlight, everything is borrowed from Krishna. And we don't even chant His name. What is that? No gratitude. Then what can we expect? This is not even manners. So so-called morality is complete farce if you don't become a devotee of Krishna. So the other verse is, actually there are many verses, but I'll just show one more before we wrap up. Shadvarga samyamai kanta sarva niyama chodana tadanta yadino yogan avaheyu shramavaha. Ritualistic ceremonies. Now Hindus, they are very much into these ritualistic ceremonies. Oh, this homam must do, that yagam must do. You know, this why we must do? Why must break the coconut? Why must? Don't know. Simply do. Huh? Ritualistic ceremonies, regulative principles, austerities, and the practice of yoga are all meant to control the senses and mind. This is the reason why we do these things. But even after one is able to control the senses and mind, if he does not come to the point of meditation upon the Supreme Lord, all such activities are simply labor in frustration. So the ultimate point is we must come to the platform of loving the Lord. And loving the Lord means to do whatever He says. First thing in love is obedience. If I really love that person, I will do whatever that person wants. right? Just like in ordinary love dealings, if somebody likes something, so on his birthday I will bring that for him, you know, because it's his favorite. So I will try to please the other person. So love means to do the best thing what he likes or she likes. So that's love. Now similarly, if we really love Krishna, if we want to love Krishna, we have to do that which pleases him. Not only on his birthday, but every day. So we must not do what we want. No, that is not devotion. Devotion means whatever Krishna wants, even if that is inconvenient for me. If that is what Krishna wants, then I will do that. That is devotion. That's what Krishna wants to see actually. Krishna, that's why it is said, Krishna does not see how much you give. Krishna sees how much you keep. Because that percentage is what your love is. If I give $10,000 in the temple, ordinary man would say, wow, this person is so devoted, he is $10,000, just like that. But maybe he has a $10 billion in his account, he's only giving $10,000. So like what, calculate the percentage, 0.001. Compared to that, if an ordinary maybe construction worker or something, he is earning only maybe $800. If he gives $300 here, oh, that's 40% of his wealth. The percentage, the amount of surrender, is not about how much, it's about how much percentage of, that is a surrender. Are we willing to give ourselves completely to Krishna, 100%? Or how much are we withholding and how much we are only giving to Krishna? That's what Krishna wants to see. That's why Krishna, you see, Prabhupada said, Krishna will see how much you keep. That determines how much our heart, because many people can say, oh, it is not about the money, it's not about the time, it's not about this, it's about our heart. What is in our heart, that will manifest outside. So if in my heart I don't have 100% love for Krishna, I will not give 100%. If in my heart I have 100% for Krishna, whatever Krishna says, I will do. Even if that means complete, you know, offering, just like Bali Maharaj, he offered his complete self to Krishna. Shukracharya was telling him, this Brahmana is a cheater, he is actually Vishnu himself. He has come, he is only asking 3 steps of land, but you don't give him, thinking that he is a very pure Brahmana. He is a cheater, he is a Vishnu himself. He is going to take everything away from you. And Bali Maharaj said, even if that is so be it. I am not going to deviate from my duty of giving the charity to a Brahmana. Or if he is a Supreme Lord, my life is perfect. I would have given everything to Krishna, the Supreme Lord. That's it. That's the perfection of my life. Why are you asking me? So he disobeyed even his guru. Because the guru said, don't give to Krishna. What kind of guru you are? Guru should say, you give everything to Krishna. I am giving everything to Krishna and you are saying no. He rejected him. This should be our, like Draupadi. You know Draupadi's case, when she was being disrobed in the assembly hall by Dushasan. She was, you know, crying. She was holding the with one hand the sari, and with the other hand she was crying, Hey Govinda, you know. But still nothing was happening. It was, and Dushasan, of course, he being a man, he was much stronger and he was pulling with such great force. And at the end she became helpless and she just raised both her hands. Hey Govinda, she called. And Krishna said, that one call of her, I am eternally indebted to her. Because of that one call, because it was complete surrender. No more even trying to protect herself with her own strength. No, Krishna, that's it. I am completely yours now. That's it. That's what Krishna wants to see. Complete surrender. Not withholding some and giving some. That's not devotion. It's good. It's a good start, I would say. But that's not the end. End must be, because when you go to Vaikuntha, there is nothing else than serving Krishna there. And if I am not practiced to do it here, I will not be admitted into Vaikuntha. I will take another birth, until I understand that I have to 100% surrender to Krishna. Until I come to that point, I am not admitted into that spiritual world there. So if we say that, oh, this material world is very bad, you know, I don't want to come back here anymore, I want to go back to Krishna, don't just say, We have to completely surrender to Krishna and do whatever he asks. Whatever the devotees ask, of course, the devotees should be following what Krishna wants. So the Guru, Sri Prabhupada said, has given us instructions, chant Hare Krishna, follow the four regulative principles, do service, come for classes, read the books, all these things. So many services, infinite services are there. So we must engage in all kinds of services and give our best for Krishna. Not that, for Krishna, I'll just do a little bit. A little bit seva once in a while, once a while. Rathyatra festival, okay, I'll cut some. That's it, next year Rathyatra, I'll see you again. What is that? I mean, it's good. I'm not saying no. It's not the best. If you really are not interested in seeing this rebirth again, then that's not enough. We have to constantly come to the point of undeviated service. We must crave, even if I cannot at the present moment because of some commitments, is that I must pray to Krishna, Krishna, please give me the intelligence, please give me the strength to serve you without deviation, without any interval. That's what we should crave for. That greed, if you are that greedy for Krishna, that is the only price that you can actually purchase Krishna with. Intense greed. So alright, we'll stop here. Grantra Srimad Bhagavad Gita Ki. Let's see if there is any questions on online. What is that? Something is going on. Alright, some appreciation from some devotees there. So no questions, so we'll stop here. Granthiraj Srimad Bhagavad Gita ki, Srila Prabhupada ki, Gaur Premanande.